Members' code of conduct, declarations of interest. Any declarations of interest this evening?
I've got one with regards to the room awards, what's a personal interest?
There's an article about personal interest in most of the committee as well. For those that went here, I've been very receptive to the chair meeting this evening because the chair's all on at the moment. Okay, we've got Max Sullivan here and Anita Leech in full. We've got Geoff and Wendy came for Tom Anderson and as well.
Okay.
Member representative.
So, a minute to the last meeting. Everyone happy with the minutes of the last meeting?
Yeah.
Okay, item three, changes to polling places and polling stations.
This is about previous meeting on the 22nd of November, minute 14, resolved that the decision to move the polling place from Christchurch City Grammar School to Christchurch Parish Centre be adjourned to a future meeting, which is today, in order that investigations can take place to see whether the school can remain open during polling day. One of the suggestions to enable it to remain open was made by Councillor Chris Brady, who suggested that barriers could be erected to provide that separation between voters and pupils. I made a visit to the school to determine the feasibility of erecting fences. Unfortunately, to enable the school to remain open, if there were fences, temporary fences erected, this would result in someone having to be on duty at all times because of the way the location of the building where the polling station is situated. That would be because to make sure there's no breach of the fence, because the area is also used as a playground, so children would be in the playground at the same time as voters were coming in to vote. Also, when the school is closed on polling day, the playground is used as parking for voters. If the school was to be open, then this would no longer be available and voters would have to park on the road. Now, this is a very busy road. It's the road that approaches the M52 motorway in Brighton. in Upton, so it's quite a busy road. And the spaces around the school will be limited during the day, especially around school opening and school closing. Also, the building that is used as the polling station is ordinarily used as classrooms. So if the building was to remain open, then these classrooms would have to be relocated, and the head teacher has indicated there isn't anywhere else to relocate the classrooms to. So in conclusion, the school is to remain as the designated polling place, but remain open on the day, then it will no longer be the most suitable venue for voters. So the recommendation is that the polling place be relocated to Christchurch Parish Centre for all future elections and referenda. However, if the recommendation is not agreed, then the status quo will continue and the school will be unable to remain open.
Okay, thank you, Kate. I'll bring in the board council to ask any questions.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks for giving me the opportunity. Thanks for deferring me for the visit. I have to say, I've said before, just wasn't the case. to making things up as you go along. I don't think if you've got a 6-foot block in their space, you need a person on duty. The playground is Astro's here, it's not used for parking or building. They do have a rear playground that they can use as an alternative. And I'll draw a conclusion with another conversation in the ward, what you see, which is the Baptist Church. And when that uses the home station, there's a nursery class going on. We also have a community cafe, people go when you get the test of that. And they don't seem to have a problem with separating the nursery from the home station. And the nursery actually opens up as the antidote is the home station. I won't know. It's the room adjacent, yeah. So it's not fair. So I think the school being a little bit pedantic and a little bit awkward, this permanent station has been there certainly as long as I can remember, 30 or 40 years. It's in the centre of, or near the centre of the Clements district. Moving it 320 metres down to the Christ Centre will disadvantage voters who live up towards that end, further right, and I believe it will result in the turn down in voter turnout. And we as a council should be encouraging voter turnout, not going out of our way to make it as difficult as possible. So I'll ask the committee to take into account all those things I've said and maintain the status quo. Thank you.
Can I ask a question, Chair, before you open just for clarification?
For clarification from him.
I can't understand all this car market. Is it after turf we park if we don't park? Can you just explain that?
The area around the building that's used for, as a polling station, there is a big squared area that is covered in AstroTurf. Adjacent to that is a paved area with, I think they're bike sheds, or they used to be used as bike sheds. It's that area that is used as the for parking. They don't park on the AstroTurf. They park on the paved area adjacent to the AstroTurf.
And there's a rear car park as well. I saw a rear playground.
I wasn't made aware of a rear playground.
And just for clarity, Chair, that parking area is room 2000. And if the polling parks and the presiding officer are parked there, there is no parking for voters.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, one last sort of time to Councillor Blake. I have a problem on the edge of my ward. I mean, it's twice on the edge. And that's the church, and that's not seeing any decrease in numbers using it. What I would say, though, is we're not in the business of forcing schools to shut. We're encouraging people to make sure their education continues. And I sympathise with Councillor Blake. I can't see the rationale of what the difference of moving is a few hundred metres down the road is going to make, because I know where Christchurch School is and where this centre is. It's not a huge difference. Just to go a bit further into a small. So I would go with the recommendation.
Thank you. I've got Julia and Andrew.
I think, Chris, you said that there was only room for two cars. Did you mean in front of the marriage centre?
No, into the school. Kate made up there was parking there for routers for the business.
Okay. You've just got to, because there is parking in the parish centre at the back as well. Okay, thank you.
I've listened to, I'll start with the arguments. I was swearing a bit to what Ron said before about the kids being put. If it's been known to me that there's a power station,
40 years, maybe even longer.
And have we any records of any accidents haven't taken place? And does the school have to close if anything made the point that it doesn't have to close? So the fact is that the arguments about parking and car parking, they're not using that as a car, they're going onto the road anyway. So in my view, I think we should leave this as it is because it's something to try and assess and it's handed to the people local. And I don't know the area, I'm going up the World Council somewhere.
I think the point that Kate made is when she's gone out and investigated. the school to have to close.
So, I'm going to pass to the chair.
Yes, and the proposal to move it is to prevent the school from closing, and that's what the school's requested.
Chair, can I just make a further comment? The problem move will be open during school times and also prior to school being open. And I know, I'm just going to have to admit that the serious parking issues around first year school of a morning and of an afternoon dropping off and picking up children. I have had numerous complaints from residents on the opposite side over to in my ward around this parking issue. So to say, you know, there's not issue, there is issues, and there could be serious issues. And you've got people coming and going to a phone booth, and you've got additional footfall other than what you have in parents dropping off. So I understand what the ward council said. It's been open for 4 years. I've phone booths that are not long, as long as that. And we changed it to the reason that we didn't want it to be in school. Used to use the nursery centre. We've now moved it into the Millennium Centre to avoid shutting schools for a period of a whole day. We don't just shut for a period of time, it's the whole day that we shut. And sometimes in the evening as well, prior to that, because we need the equipment. But, you know, I think it's the distance is not a huge inconvenience to people.
Thank you. Anita.
Thanks, Chair. I know the area quite well, as Rob said, it was opposite to our ward. I think the inconvenience that is caused to parents who plot to find alternative people to come back to their children while school is closed or not particularly there. Is more of an inconvenience than people have to walk 325 metres. So I'd be looking to go with the recommendation.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. I do know the idea, and I might have to refer to it. So I do know the service centre, the community centre as well, addressing part of the one that is involved in the church. As Ron said, the distance is negligible in that respect. You have to be taking cars off the highway at times when it will be congested. Also the safety of school children, I'm sure the teacher and staff can certainly technology and data protection and the new laws that are coming in, that they need to make sure that the children are safe all the time. So I'm quite happy to agree with that.
Okay, there's no other comments, so do you stand with your proposal? You said that you'd support.
I think I'm supposing that I wouldn't listen to all the debate now.
Right, okay. So, there's a proposal from Ron to go with the recommendation of relocating the arm station as an alternative proposal.
Yeah. Should we second
it? Should we second it? An alternative proposal then? Okay, do we have a vote on that then? All those in favour of the recommendation to move and relocate the power station? Okay, thank you, that's unanimous.
Thank you.
Thanks very much for the board as well.
Recommended by the Wirral working party, which met in December. Assembly last year. Members will have communicated to them the individual recommendations in respect of each nominee, and the report asks the members to confer the resolution upon those recipients as recommended, and also to endorse appropriate arrangements for the presentation of the ceremony of the award to take place as set out in paragraph 3 of the report. Just for the background information, the Wirral working party was attended by the mayor, the leader of council, an invitation for us given to each spokesperson in respect of the three political parties around the table.
I've
got one comment in relation, to 3-3, and it's a wrong removal string for nominee, so that goes.
What's that, what did you say?
Nominee or nominee, because it states the group means change license only. So, or nominee.
I think that's one of the particular nominee plus a guest of that nominee.
No, I was talking
about if you read it, it says the mayor will give the council group leaders chair of licensing. Where it says group leaders chair of licensing,
in those
two particular cases.
Okay, so because of that slight amendment,
set the current fleet and industry issues in context. You have a limit of 289 happy carriage vehicles. That was imposed on the 23rd of January 2012. At the time we actually did the bank work, which was in March, there were 258 vehicles on the books. So the operational performance we're talking about is really based on that level of 258 vehicles. That's how many were available to service the demand we were observing. One of the things that, as we looked at the stats, is very important. In this area, your hackney carriage vehicle fleet provides the bulk of wheelchair accessible vehicles for the area. All the hackney carriages are wheelchair accessible, but there are not many, if any, wheelchair accessible vehicles on private hire site. When the limit was first removed, many private hire vehicles actually transferred to hackney carriage, and that reduced the levels of private hire and increased the level of hackney carriage. But when you look at the stats since the limit's been back on, private hire levels would often increase when that happens, but actually they also decreased as well as the hackney carriages decreasing, which is saying something about the actual demand for licensed vehicles in the area. And interestingly, the number of private hire vehicles at the moment is about the same as it was in 2012. First imposed. Driver numbers have also been reducing on both sides, except for in the last year when there's been a slight increase in hackney carriage and private hire in this last year. We need to rewatch what happened at length. This is the main place that you can see what's going on with hackney carriages. We looked at 245 hours. We found Fridays and Saturdays were the busiest, but actually were quite similar to one another. When you look at the graph that's there, and I have some larger copies of the graph if people don't want them, basically there's very little happens overnight. You can see this, often you'll have things that go down and stay there, whereas the graph clearly shows Friday night was a dead period in the early hours of Saturday, and Saturday night was a dead period in the early hours of Sunday. It's slightly more mistaken in the Saturdays than it is on the Fridays, but basically, you know, things die once you get later on. Very clearly from the graph, the busiest rank is Asda in Birkenhead, which gives you 40% of the estimated passenger numbers in a typical week. Clawton Road, just round the corner from that, gets 18%, the ranking list card 16%. New Brighton does have some active carriage activity, but it's not focused on the formal rank. When we actually did a comparison back to 1998, overall active carriage demand compared to then is about 25% less. However, the data we just collected in 2017 was 42% higher than the data that was collected in the last study in 2012, at the time at which the limit was put on. That's mainly down to the Asda rank, which when the previous survey was done, Asda was being developed. So that wasn't there, whatever the equivalents were doing quite so much. Since the last survey in 2012, a lot of night and other venues have actually closed. Interestingly, in the meantime, there have been developments of the New Brighton which have gone, and now they're gone. However, we did find that there still remain six active ranks, one of which gets fair service, four of them get good service, and one of them gets very good service. So that's quite a good track record for what the ranks are achieving. And when we actually checked on vehicles we saw about half of the hackney carriage fleet during the Friday. Sample observations. We talked to people in the streets, and three quarters of them said they'd used a licensed vehicle in the last 3 months. That's split between hackney carriage and private hire. And that the overall number of trips was pretty high compared to what we'd see nationally. It's 4.1 trips per person per month for all vehicles, of which 0.7 comes out of hackney carriage. Now that proportion there is about the same as the 15% of people who said they got their licensed vehicles from the bank. find that the phone bookings were made at the time we did the survey to two companies, took the bulk of bookings, but since we've done the survey, those two companies have actually merged. So most people that phoned for a vehicle phoned that. Over half the people we talked to couldn't actually remember when they asked you back at the carriage rather than a private hire. Most people we talked about banks, the main bank they knew about was Hamilton Square. And the main desire for doing banks was that we knew Brighton. People were more confident of getting out of the carriage in the day than at night. But when we actually looked at their inability to get a taxi, it was lower overall, so people can generally get them when they want. We looked at latent demand, which is actually asking people if they've ever given up waiting for a taxi in the area, and that was actually quite low compared to what we've seen in other places. But we did find that people basically knew that they could get a hackney carriage by going to a bank, but they didn't have any understanding that they could hail one. And we think that's a lack within people's understanding of what they can and can't do. We talked to stakeholders, supermarkets, the police, all sorts of people who either they or their customers may well use hackney carriage or private hire. Most of the key stakeholders we talked to actually use private hire and phone bookings. When we talked to the police, they did say they felt there was a vehicle shortage of both hackney and private hire, and that happened to be worse at weekends, particularly overnight. However, looking at things, we feel that even bus services around here are not that frequent or that often. And we had a quick look at the overall timetables and found that public transport provision in the world is generally low apart from the rail services. We talked with some night economy representatives. We sat around the table with them, and they told us that there were various places that may have particular issues where demand for hackney carriage or private hire wasn't serving their customers, so they couldn't get people home. We did ask that they would talk with us and work with us, but nothing more happened on that. But they did put the point that their customers were often frustrated in not being able to get home, which did affect their business. And even for people knowing the area, we found there was some concern about deter journeys from some parts of that. I'm afraid that spread to me, because every time I've come here, I've always had a significant doubts on whether I can actually get home. I have now found out how to get home, but I've had two very early journeys. My last journey wasn't helped by the being rail strike, and I got to my train with 30 seconds to spare. The previous one was a little less hairy, but I did end up waiting here half an hour waiting for a bit of private time. So it just made me feel that for businesses, things aren't quite what they should be. And if you have businessmen coming here to the town hall, there's an issue. We did some mystery shopping. We did some by making phone calls asking for wheelchair accessible vehicles and typical vehicles. We also went to a day where someone went to try to get out of the area. And the interesting and amazing thing was that the person that went round found good service from the active banks and good service on the trips that they undertook with the carriages. And basically, they were able to get a hackney carriage in Brighton if they actually they went into Mollison's and they said, I want a black cab. And Mollison's phoned for a black cab and he came quite quickly. There was only one bank further out where they couldn't get that sort of service, so they were quite pleased with that. So whether a bank's now active or where people know about hackney carriages, it does provide a good service. When we looked at the size of things looking at wheelchair accessibility, and making telephone calls and comparing between trying to get a cab and trying to get a wheelchair accessible cab. We tested three different ways of phoning for those, and basically the carriage park gave very good service. One private hire company also gave good but not quite so good service, and there was a smaller private hire company that wasn't really able to meet needs all the time. So that was a sort of a patchy view. But remember, all of the wheelchair accessible basically come from the NK side, so if a person hasn't got that link, then if you phone a company that hasn't got those links, it's going to struggle. When we looked at the bank surveys, one of the amazing things from Wirral that we found, which we don't find in other places, is that there is a high usage of apple carriages by people in wheelchairs at banks. That doesn't always happen, but that's a very positive and good point. Where people know they can get a wheelchair accessible vehicle at banks, they make use of it and that happens here in the morning. So that's a very good point. We talked to the trade. Everyone in the trade was asked to take part, they were aware of it. We got a typical level of response from the trade, as normally we get more from active carriage and from client hire, but we did get a reasonable mix. 86% of those that we talked to, including many from the private hire side, actually said that the living should be retained. We found when we looked at working hours that people quoted, active carriage tend to work longer hours and more days than private hire. And basically between both lots of licensed vehicles, there's cover for about half the available hours in the week, clearly there. Private hire only tend to cover about a third, and happy carriage cover quite a lot more of the hours in between the mix. That covers about half the hours definitely with vehicles available. And we had some very good help from the happy carriage reps and from specific people in the happy carriage train actually gave us some very useful information that helped us understand how things work here in Wirral. So the conclusions from all these various bits that we've done. At the present, there is no unmet demand in this area which is significant. The present demand for both active carriage and private hire is disparate and low volume. Acne carriage and private hire, however, are very important to the economy. They're a very key way of getting around. There is a need to reverse the spiral of decline, as I say, things have gone down since 2012, but that needs to be turned around for the sake of the economy of the area, really. However, when I sat and thought it through, and I do this work all over the country, and this is a very relatively unique conclusion, that the removal or leaving the limit is unlikely to resolve any issues that we've identified and that you've got here. There is a strong need for public education of what you can and can't get and how you get vehicles if you need them. There is a need to encourage trade innovation for the trade to move forwards and continue to move forwards into the current present options with people getting licensed vehicles. And there's also a need for the people who are complaining about the lack of service to actually work with the trade to ensure that the area has a service that meets developing needs and puts the area in a good place for those there and visiting. As I say, it's taken me three visits to work out how, if I was a businessman, I could get to a point in town hall okay. I haven't tried it yet. But you know, I'm here late, so that shows I was a little more trust than perhaps I had. But it's very important that you know what's provided here in licensing actually allows the trade to develop and be a good source of helping the economy of the Wirral move forward and onwards. So that's my rambling's completed. There's a lot more in the report. Happy to take questions.
Okay, thank you. I'm Andrew. Awesome.
Just, you mentioned trade innovation. I don't know what that means, but can you expand on that? What do you mean by that?
Obviously, everyone's aware that there are things called apps developing, and those need to be happening everywhere because that's the one way that a lot of people get licensed vehicles. So that you need to make sure that things fit so that can happen. There's also other matters where you try to make sure that people are advertising their services as widely as possible and making themselves as available as possible. I noticed that you know the habit here is not to put bus stop signs on bus stops. And when I went back out from here the last time I went back, I looked at the bus stop and I thought, is it out of use? So the same is true. I once went somewhere and found that Hackney Cabbage used to save power and to save a bit of money and actually disconnected the lights on their lights so that they couldn't actually switch their lights on when they were available. You know, so it's little things like that, making sure that the trade is about and putting itself out of the bounds and saying, driving home as well as Hackney Cabbage. But there are lots of opportunities, lots of ways people build business, and that needs to be thought about and taken forward. But we just need to make sure as a committee, in order to get the policies and the things you have, that you have ways to encourage rather than dissuade.
Thanks, Dave. Thank you.
Chair, yes. Ian, thank you for this. It's an excellent report. Very comprehensive. When you delve into it, there's lots of reasons why, or why you don't. I represent a part of the peninsula that doesn't see a hacking cap from 1 year to the next. That's Eastern, by the way, lads. And on the report, it does a sentence concentrated in the centre of Birkenhead. And honestly, it doesn't affect any other parts of the peninsula where there's over a third of a million people that live and possibly could be attracted to using this type of transport. My area now, especially you mentioned the problems you have with public transport and moving around, since the latest round of changes to public transport has taken place, it's harder for people to move. Now maybe these operators need to look a little bit further afield. There are people who live in my area travel greatly from Eastern to Bromley on a regular basis because of the major shopping centres. There's the ability for them to enhance their business if you wish. But it does say, as it says in your report, I think it's educating people to understand that blackouts are there and you can actually head up in the streets. You don't have to call them. But then there is the downside to that. It's in your report, but most of the large establishments, supermarkets, and I saw it today in the hospital, where there's a phone on the wall and people want a taxi just straight away. But most importantly, they come up to the report to me, is that the percentage of people who are disabled and need a larger vehicle basically rely on blackheads. I don't know why it's not more highly advertised and promoted in that way to assist them. I mean, in your comments coming down, it doesn't highlight those particular issues.
I think, I sat and scratched my head because I don't really like writing reports that don't give answers, but I don't think what I can do in my gift actually gives any answers because the questions are wider than just the pure licensing side of things. A lot of it is to do with the economy and how that's promoted, but there are things that can be done. One of the interesting things I look at sit down and in my musings, don't take me seriously in this, but in my musings I sit down and think if I was developing a licensed vehicle service for Wirral now, with the current situation, not coming from the past, but starting afresh, what sort of fleet would I have? And one of the issues is that obviously a wheelchair accessible vehicle costs more to run than a non-wheelchair accessible vehicle, but it does a lot more. And there's a balance between those things. But if you've got low demand that's not really coping with the costs that you have to provide that, you do have to start sitting thinking, you know, what's happening here? And I don't want to say much more, but I think as a committee you've got to sit long and hard and think things are there that we want, what do we want for this? What are the aims for our licensed vehicle services? And it's got to be that you actually underpinning the rebuilding of the economy. But what sort of things do you want for that? And what changes that will allow, you know, a better development and a